were a couple of things yesterday that I hadn't quite covered that I wanted to share with you this morning. And I don't have anyone new here now. But anyhow, the sanctuary and the Day of Atonement. And I'm going to ask Brother this board to be put up here, right? Because there's some things, as I said, that I didn't get to share with you yesterday, and I want to make sure that you get them. Of course, this is the court. We see here the holy place, and back here the most holy place. Some people get confused at times, and I can see how, and especially when you read Leviticus 16, as to where the priest is on the Day of Atonement. So our little group here at the church, we studied that verse by verse, and I'll get that covered that towards the end of the presentation. But in here we have what? What is this? Well, let's first of all go back here. The brazen altar. Something very significant about the brazen altar is the grate. The grate was made of brass. The outside of it was made of wood, which represented what?
Humanity.
What was it?
Humanity.
Humanity, okay. And the brass represents strength. All right, so we have this, but in between, this is 54 inches high. And in between, which half of 54 is what? 27. Okay, so this grate here is just as high as the mercy seat is in the most holy place. And I love this as I read it. This signifies God's mercy is as great as his justice. In Christ, mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Psalms 85:10. And then the next place I want to go to is to cover the skins. We talked a little bit about it yesterday, but there are four coverings. And all four coverings represents characteristics of Christ. The outer, the royal covering. We'll start inside and work our way out. The royal covering is an exalted Savior. Wherefore God hath highly exalted him. Philippians 2:9. Then we go to the next one, the white covering. He was made of goat's hair. It represents a sinless Savior. He was made perfect through suffering. Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. Let's get those Bibles out. And I'm just praying that this will motivate you to study for yourself. But Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. Oh, no, wait a minute. Yeah. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10 and 11. We read, "For it became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things, and bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren." Now I have to make a confession. When I met my husband, who those who knew him, he was a beautiful Christian. And when I met his sons, that I was to become their stepmother, I just cringed. And It really bothered me, this long hair and the whole works. And then one day my husband just gently said, he says, you know, Christ died for them too. And that put a whole different picture in my mind. Christ died for them too. And I know David and Elvis and Morgan, those working in other countries may come into some very undesirable situations with working with people. Well, you can even do it here in this country. I mean, if you go to New York City down at the Bowery, I mean, it's just amazing. It's not a nice amazing. And so it really helped me a lot to realize, yes, that Christ died for them too. Okay, and if they're saved, of course, they'll have the righteousness of Christ. Then the next one is ram skin dyed red, a sacrificial savior. He became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And the badger skin represents a lowly savior. He humbled himself to walk among sinful man. All this can be found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, and then Hebrews 2, 10 and 11. Now, we can know all of this. We can have it down pat. We know what the gold represents. We know what the angels represent, the white curtains and all. But brothers and sisters, what we need is the experience. We need the experience. And so we're going to walk through that today. A little bit about the again the golden table and the table of showbread. Remember, this is bread. This is the showbread they put on the table of showbread, and they had 12 loaves or cakes or whatever you want to call it. Why 12? The 12 tribes of Israel, right? And then Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." Jesus is the bread of life. And we're told that the word, when we take the word, studying God's word, we are to masticate it. You know what that means? You put it in and you chew and you chew and you chew and you chew. You are, you know, as you're chewing this piece of bread, it's becoming part of you. And brothers and sisters, as we partake of the bread of life, Christ, by feeding on his word, we too will become like him, taking him into our life. And here we have the altar of incense. Your prayer life, how's your prayer life going? Is it we kneel, say a quick prayer, we're on our way? Or do we commune with God? If you have a real close friend, and you go to visit them, and they'll say in about, well, I got to go now. I've got to do the dishes, or I have to go take care of the chickens, feed them, whatever. Would you appreciate that? I wouldn't. When Georgie came the other day, I wanted her to come over to my house. Let's sit and visit a while. And this is how the Lord wants us to deal with him. He wants to talk with us. He wants to talk to us. He talks to us through his word, the still small voice. And we talk to him by prayer. And then the candlestick, you can't see it very well, but Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And we were talking a lot yesterday during the witnessing time about answered prayer. And I'm glad for this. And every day I see answered prayer. Just this morning, Tam and I were going up to Beckley, and all of a sudden, what do you think we saw?
A bear.
A bear.
Really?
We would say between 250, I'm judging it according to the size of it compared to some people I know. But this bear was somewhere between 250 and 3 pounds. It was a lot bigger than the one we had out here. And so, I think Pamela remembers, I said, thank you, Lord, you know. I love it when he brings these little serendipities into our lives. And so we thank him. But now we're talking about sanctification. Where is the text? Sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth.
John 17:17,
right. Okay, I know we tried to avoid the word Trinity, triangles, things like that. But I'm sorry, I call this my golden triangle. Why do I call it my golden triangle? Feeding upon God's word. Praying, communing with him. Telling him the burdens on my heart. And then sharing. Now, since I work here in the office, I don't get out, you know, to visit like I would like or had in the past. But, you know, people will call in and they'll ask me questions, you know, or would you send this piece of literature? And as soon as they say something like that, I say to them, well, how did you come across this? You know, and just recently a woman called and she says, I will always keep the Sabbath from now on.
Amen.
And I said, well, what brought this about? She says, I had stopped at a rest stop on I-40 and went into a little chapel, and there was some of our literature. It's amazing what can happen when we leave literature here and there. And she says, I read it, and then she says, I looked around for more, like, you know, from the same place. Then she went on to our website. She says, I've got to, and she gave me a list of everything she wanted. Well, that just thrills my soul when something like that transpires. And so anyhow, the man that does it, I have never met him personally, but the man that does that, he called me just the other day, and he said, I want 500 of this track, that track, and so forth. And I told him the experience. And so God's word is getting out. God is still in business. He's still working on our hearts. And so I like to encourage you. Let's take just a little bit more time with the Lord. Reading his word along with the spirit of prophecy and prayer. I've been very guilty with prayer. But so, you know, I'm in a hurry, and so I know how it can be, but we need to spend time with the Lord. And when was the time that Jesus spent most of his time communing with his Father? At night and early morning. Right. And then, of course, he was always witnessing. He did more good things, you know, than he actually preached. So this, in order for us to be sanctified, sanctification to take place in each of our lives, we need to read God's word, pray, and witness, share. You know, when you get good news, you've got to share it with others. Okay, we're going to go in here into the most holy place. Now, I'll get back here in a minute. In this area here, in the holy place, or the tabernacle of the congregation, there was something going on every day. You had the trimming of the wicks in the lamp. You had the putting the oil in. You had prayer was offered up twice a day, And these were taken care of morning and evening also. But it was only on Sabbath that they put the bread, put fresh bread on the table of showbread. And what they took off was divided among the priests. Now we'll go into the most holy place, or the Holy of Holies. As the veil is drawn back and the Holy of Holies is exposed before you, behold the Ark of the Covenant, the most sacred place in the sanctuary. Now, the Ark of the Covenant was 27 inches long and 27 inches high. Glittering with gold, it was a gold box with a wood box with a gold box. And representing the wood, representing humanity, and the gold representing divinity. Now, Christ came to this world, but before he could come here, he had to take on humanity. But before we can enter the kingdom, we have to take on divinity. We have to take on his character. And there was also in the ark, of course, the two stones. Now, I want to turn. There's a certain place I wanted to share with you. I'll read this so I don't mess up. The tables of stone on which God wrote the Ten Commandments are called tables of the testimony. And the ark is called the ark of the testimony, Exodus 32:15, and Exodus 36. The Hebrew meaning of the word testimonies is witness or evidence of proof. Thus, the Ten Commandments are a witness of our God's authority. They are the evidence and proof that the great Creator is the only true God. The Ten Commandments are a transcript of God's character. God wrote the commandments in tables of stone. It is His desire to write them in our hearts. The tables are written on both sides. Let's turn to Exodus 32:15. I'd like for you to all see this one now. Exodus 32. Are you there?
Amen.
Exodus 32. Again, I lost my spot. 32:15. And Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two tables of the testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides. On the one side and on the other side were they written. Now, we had quite a little discussion over at our house one night this week about this very thing. And so I don't know exactly, you know, if it's, I think, I'll put it this way, I think that as you would look at the two different tablets, you have the first four on the left and the other six on the right. And if you were to turn these tablets over, you would have the first four on the left and the six on the right. Well, I don't know. I could be wrong. I could be wrong. But it was written twice. Why? Why was it written twice? Let's turn to John 8:17. John 8:17. The Bible says, "It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true." Let's go to 2 Corinthians 13:1. The third time I am coming to you, in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. All right, let's go to Deuteronomy, back in the Old Testament, 17. Deuteronomy chapter 17. At the mouth of two or three witnesses shall he that is worthy of death be put to death, but at the mouth of one witness he shall not be put to death. And then Genesis chapter 41, Genesis 41. Genesis 41, verse 32. "And for that the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice. It is because the thing is established by God, and God will shortly bring it to pass." So, within the box there, the Ark of the Covenant, you had the law of God. Now, if there's no law, can we break it? Where there's no law, you can't break a law. But here, God gave us this law. And you know, I'm happy, I'm glad that we have laws. I know a year or so, a few years ago, I wasn't too happy, but I was able to drop the charges. But I was going just a little too fast, and I wasn't very happy. That I wasn't upset with the policeman, but I was upset with myself because I was doing 22 miles over. But what's that?
Just a little.
But I'm glad for laws. Like, we go into town and there's that stoplight and I'm in a hurry, but I yield. I stop and I yield. So God, you know, he has laws for us. I'm glad. Thou shalt not steal. I'm sure glad for that, because I don't want people to think they can come in and take whatever they want anytime. I'm glad for laws. And I really don't like to hear profanity. You know, my husband, I never heard a bad word out of his mouth. Never in 40 years. And so when I hear it, It's very offensive. So I'm glad that we're not to take God's name in vain. That's one of his laws. And any time, you know, I think of the law of God as a fence around me. It's protecting me. And in there also was the pot of manna, as well as Aaron's rod that budded. I do have questions, and if any of you have answers to this, I would like to know. But they talk about Aaron's rod and the manna in it or on side of it. Because when they describe it in Exodus, it doesn't say that they have a pocket somewhere or whatever. Can you help me on that, Brother David? So I'm thinking that that it was actually inside the ark, the two articles inside the ark, but off to the side. Now, do we have any questions so far here? Okay, if not, I want to go over here to the high priest. Now, this is the clothing that he wore every day. He had the white, first of all, he had white breeches, a white robe, a blue robe, and then the ephod and the breastplate. And Dorothy and Iran, they've had a great time going around trying to find stones to match it as closely. And I do have the stone somewhere in my attic. But I just can't locate them right now. But these stones have some significance. And I really want to get into studying it more. Because what are stones made of? Clay and sand. Clay and sand, that's the basis. And what are we made of? We're made of the soil too, aren't we? And they say if you cremate someone, that you just get down to ashes. And so I got to thinking, as I was reading about the stones, each stone has a different type of mineral in it. And that determines the color. And I thought, could there be any chance that the stones would, there has to be a correlation between the stones and people, personality I'm referring to. I don't know. I think it's something worth checking it out, studying it through. So anyhow, at the bottom of his blue robe, he had pomegranates and bells. And the bells would tingle when he was doing his chores inside the holy place. In this section here, not this. And they say that they tied a rope around his leg in case he died, they pulled him out. You don't believe everything you read on the internet. And on the breastplate, he had 12 stones. And these were precious and semi-precious stones. And each stone represented a certain tribe. And these stones you'll find in the foundation of the city. And so whenever the priests went into the holy place, times to put blood on the altar of incense, or he would have that breastplate on his heart. And you know, Jesus today carries us on his heart. Isn't that beautiful? Now, on the Day of Atonement, he did not go into the most holy place in this. He went in with white breeches, a white robe, a white girdle, and a white mitre. He didn't have this little crown-like with him.
Just Mr. Aaron, why is the law blue there? The tablets, I mean, the testimonies?
Well, I've studied different things, and I'm implying, I can't say 100% positive, but for me it's 99%, that it was blue. Because blue represents obedience to the law. And this is what man has violated. They have violated the law. And when a sinner would come and offer his sacrifice here on the north side, remember the north side, that's where Lucifer wanted his throne? He wanted to be on the sides of the north because he knew that's where God's throne was. And so anyhow, they would bring it in here. And when they would get ready to sacrifice the lamb or the bullock or a ram, they would place their hands on the head of the victim. And I understand that it wasn't just a casual, that the weight of the person went onto that animal. He would be, by faith now, he would be going in here by faith into where the law of God is that he had violated. And so then they would go ahead, sometimes burn the whole sacrifice. We mentioned yesterday, there are four different types of sin offerings, and there are many types of offerings. But now I think what I want to do is, let's take this. I just, you know, when you learn something special for someone, it causes you to feel closer to that person. And Pastor David is one of them. Because I never connected. There's a lot I did not connect until I heard him speak a year or so ago. But at the end of our program, we're going to pass these out. Anybody wants some, you know, let us know and we'll gladly give them to you. Daniel 8:14, we all know it. Let's read it. Unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. And no, the sanctuary is not this earth. As we look, I've got Daniel 9:26. Let's turn to that. Daniel 9:26. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. Reading verse 27. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week he shall be cut. No, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Now let's go to Isaiah 55:3. I'm not going to go through all of them, but key ones. Isaiah 55:3 reads, he is despised and rejected of men.
Chapter 53, verse 3.
Mm-hmm. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief.
And that's 53.
You want 53:5.
That's
Isaiah 53.
What's that? Isaiah 53:5.
53:5.
Oh, 53.
I'm sorry.
I know that yet.
Okay, right. Okay, I'm sorry. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. But to think Christ went through all of this for us because of our sins, our insubordination. I think if you're in the service and you get involved in something like that, that there's court-martial. Right. So we know that Christ died in A.D. 31. But there, back in 457 B.C., Daniel 9:24-27, and Ezra 7:11-13. Let's read that one. Ezra 7. Ezra chapter 7. Seven and starting in verse 11. I make a decree. Now, Artaxerxes was on the throne at that time, and there were three decrees made all to that period. But the one that really went into effect, we can find here in chapter 7, verse 11. Now, this is the copy of the letter that King Artaxerxes gave unto Ezra the priest, the scribe, even a scribe of the words of the commandments of the Lord and of his statutes. Artaxerxes, king of kings, unto Ezra the priest, a scribe of the law of God of heaven, perfect peace, and at such a time I make a decree that all they of the people of Israel and of his priests and the Levites and all in my realm, which are minded of their own free will to go up to Jerusalem, go with thee. Now, God even works through non-Christians. And so he made it, it had to be God that laid it on the heart of Artaxerxes to issue this decree. And he not only issued the decree, but he also provided materials and everything they needed to finish the walls there. So anyhow, this took place in 457 BC. And then Christ was anointed. His baptism took place 3.5 years before Calvary. And that took place in A.D. 27. Now, as I said, we're going to give you these cards. It's very important that you study them out. And all of a sudden, things begin to click how prophecy, the three angels' messages, the sanctuary, it all comes together. So in A.D. 27 was Christ's baptism. A.D. 31, he was cut off. That was Calvary. In A.D. 34, the message was taken to the Gentiles. Then there was an 1,810-year period. That brought us up to 1844, and in 1844 begins the investigative judgment. And this is why I cannot agree with Desmond Ford's theology that when Christ went back to heaven, he went into the Most Holy, went into just the one apartment sanctuary. No. So now I want to talk about the Day of Atonement. No, I'm trying to cram so much in a short time. Let's turn to Leviticus. Where's the Day of Atonement in Leviticus? 16. Right. Let's go to 16. Leviticus 16. After the death of Aaron's two sons, the Lord said, "Speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place, within the veil before the mercy seat." Now, when they talk about within the veil, what are they talking about?
The most holy place.
Okay. I need that board back up here. Thank you. Speak unto Aaron thy brother that he come not at all times into the most holy place within the veil. So, in other words, he was not to go into this section. He said, we don't go in there. Verse 3 says, Aaron comes into the holy place with a young bullock for a sin offering, and a place and a ram for a burnt offering. Now, this chapter can be very confusing if you don't understand the different departments and what transpired in those apartments. See, it says he came into the holy place with a bullock. He wouldn't take a bullock into the holy place or the most holy place. The court here, at this, he's talking about the court, because that is where the offerings, the sacrifices were made. So he would take his bullock and for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. And that was in the court. Verse 4, Aaron, watch this, Aaron washes his flesh in water and puts on. Now, he washes his flesh with water in here. And he puts on a linen coat, linen breeches, linen girdle, and a linen mitre. And that takes place in the holy place. Following me? Verse 5, Aaron takes of the congregation of the children of Israel two kids of the goats for a sin offering and one ram for a burnt offering. Now, where are the offerings made? In the court. And reading verse 6, Aaron offers his bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and makes an atonement for himself. Oops, there's that word atonement. Was there an atonement made out here? Morgan says, yeah. You all agree with that? Yes, every day when a sinner brought a victim and would confess his sins, kill that victim, and as we remember last night, all the sinner can do is kill the victim. That's all he can do. It's the priest that cuts off the fat that's burned. And all we can do is confess our sins. Christ is the one that has to come into our heart and get rid of the sin, cut off the fat. So Aaron, he offers his bullock for a sin offering, which is for himself, and makes an atonement for himself and for his house. Because someone asked me, did the women do it? I see no record where a woman would offer a sacrifice, but I know in some instances, Alan's going to check it out for me. That's good. But I know sometimes there were homes that with the, were no men in the home, so I don't know how they handled that. Maybe Alan can find it. So in verse 7, Aaron takes two goats and presents them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle, which would have been here, the door of the tabernacle. He brings two goats there. And he presents them before the Lord. He casts lots upon the two goats, one for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat, or Satan. And that takes place in the court. The scapegoat is presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him. Go and let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. So what they would do is when they would cast these lots, sometimes they were maybe like wood made of wood, and then later on gold. But they would cast these lots. Now, this is not in the scripture, and I don't usually like to use too much from the Mishnah. But in the Mishnah, it says that they would tie a ribbon around the neck of the Lord's goat and a ribbon around the horns of the scapegoat so they would not get them mixed up. And also, when they selected these goats, they had to be as much alike as possible, without spot and without wrinkle, pointing to the Lamb of God. Aaron brings the bullock, verse 11. Then Aaron brings the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and shall make an atonement for himself and for his house, and shall kill the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself. This is taking place in the court. Verse 12. Aaron shall take a censer. Now this, remember by this time, the last time we read that, Aaron had taken off these garments and put on all white. He takes a censer. You see, there's a little censer there. And that censer was always kept by the altar of incense. He takes the censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full sweet incense beaten small. Holy place, they say in the Bible, and bring it within the veil. But when you take it, you put the coals on there. And then he would go to the edge of the curtain, walk, until he got in front of the mercy seat. He never, when he went into the most holy place, he never turned his back on the ark. He went in one end and came out the other. Verse 13 says, he puts incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, the ark, that he die not. At this point, he is in the holy, most holy place. Verse 14, he takes the blood of the bullock and sprinkles. This is the second time he goes back in. It's just not a one-time thing. The first time he takes in the censer with the incense. Then he comes out and he makes a couple of trips in there. He takes the bull of the bullock and sprinkles it with his finger upon and before the mercy seat seven times. Verse 15. He comes back out. In verse 15, then he kills the goat of the sin offering that is for the people. He kills the goat out in the court and takes the blood within the veil, the most holy place. Within the veil, and do the same with that blood as he did with the blood of the bullock. Verse 16, he makes an atonement for the holy place, the most holy place. First, he makes an atonement in the most holy place. Then, he makes an atonement coming out into the holy place or the tabernacle of the congregation. And he goes to the brazen altar. Holy place. Then he goes to the altar of incense. And he makes an atonement at that point. Then he comes out to the brazen altar and touches the horns of the brazen altar also with the blood. Verse 18, he shall go out unto the altar and make an atonement for it, and shall take the blood of the bullock and the blood of the goat and put it on the horns of the altar round about, and that is in the court. He then sprinkles the blood with his finger upon the altar seven times and cleanse it and hallow it from all uncleanness of the children of Israel. This takes part in the court. When he have made an end of reconciling the holy place, or the most holy place, the Bible says holy place, but it's the most holy place, in the tabernacle of the congregation, the tabernacle of the congregation is the holy place. And the altar, and bring the live goat. Verse 21 says, Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him, that's the scapegoat, away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. And the goat shall bear upon him all their iniquities unto a land not inhabited, and he shall let go the goat in the wilderness. Now, what would be the antitypical method of this live goat? I mean, or what I'm trying to question you is, just as the live goat with the sins were taken off in the wilderness, this is like the 1,000 years that Christ will be here on this earth.
Satan.
This, right. Thank you for catching that. And then Aaron, shall wash his flesh in water in the holy place and put on his garments and come forth and offer his burnt offering and the burnt offering of the people and make an atonement for himself in the court. And the fat of the sin offering shall be burned upon the altar. That is the altar in the court. All of this has significance, and we don't have to, we need to know this because it shows us how close we are to the end of time. Verse 26, and he, the fit man, that let go the goat for the scapegoat, washed his clothes and bathed his flesh in water outside the camp and afterward come into the camp. The bullock for the sin offering and the goat for the sin offering, whose blood was brought in to make an atonement in the holy place, shall one carry forth without, outside the camp. All we have to do in this day and age is confess our sins. That's all we have to do. Before, they had to go through all this ritual. But all we have to do is confess our sins, because we are told in 1 John 1:9, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But I want to go back to that chart. It was in 1830s, early 1830s, 1833, that they had what they called the blowing of the trumpets. And that was to let the people know that the Day of Atonement was near. And so today, I mean, that's been how many years ago? A long time. And here we are still. And why are we not ready? Simply because of insubordination. It's something that's within us, and unless we have a real connection with Christ, we're not going to be able to stand. And after 1833, when they had the blowing of the trumpets, William Miller, the Millerite movement, came up. And then after that, in 1843, we had the first angel and the second angel's message. And let's turn to Revelation 14. Revelation 14. My Bible's coming apart. Revelation 14, 6. And I saw an angel fly in the midst of heaven. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. How are we to fear God?
Obey him.
What's that?
Obey him.
Obey him. Because we fear him, the fear that we think of usually, that's not the kind of fear, but we're to reverence him and to obey him, not because we are fearful of him, but because we love him. For the hour of his judgment is come. God's being judged too. We need to vindicate his character. And with vindicating his character, that only can be done if we've had the experience of the sanctuary of personal study, prayer, and witnessing. And then you had, in verse 8, and there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And I wished I had it with me, but I don't. But I was reading, and my husband pointed out many times before, Babylon is fallen, is fallen. They're not talking about the Catholic Church here. They're talking about the Protestant, all the Protestant churches. And the third angel followed, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and the Lamb. So we have a work to do. We need to be busy proclaiming the third angel's message. Well, you've got to accept the first angel's message, the second, before you can accept the third. But in ministry, testimonies to ministers, want to read you something. I just get too nervous when I'm up here. What's Christ's righteousness? The righteousness of Christ is pure, unadulterated truth. And unless we are experiencing that pure, unadulterated truth, we can't have unity. Thank you.